We question our daily position, seeking answers and definitions. Get the queries off your chest with Ahkam SOS.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, my dear brothers and sisters and dear viewers wherever you may be, and welcome to this new episode of Ahkam SOS, the show that discusses your jurisprudential questions and your Islamic duties. I know this is not your regular host and I know you miss your host Mohsin Shah. My name is Minhal Al-Khafaji and inshallah I will be your host for today. But the most important thing is that we answer your questions. Now you can send in your questions via email ahkamsos@imamhussein.tv, or you can call in, as this is a live show, on 0203-515-0199, or you can WhatsApp in your questions to the number down below. But without further ado, Ahkam SOS with Sheikhna, Sheikh Ali Ma'al Sheikhna, assalamu alaikum.
Alaykum as-salam wa rahmatullah.
How are you doing tonight,
Alhamdulillah.
Alhamdulillah. Now, Sheikhna, there's so many questions that have been sent in. Many viewers wanting to know the opinions of different maraji' on certain issues. I've had a read through the questions. They're actually pretty decent questions. So we'll start with the first one. The first question says, Assalamu alaikum. What is the ruling if there is some dirt on the turba or mor that prevents the forehead from touching the actual turba?
Inshallah. أعوذ بالله السميع العليم من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين وصلى الله على محمد وآله الطيبين الطاهرين ولعنة الله على أعدائهم أجمعين. It is mandatory and wajib for the individual to make sure that when he performs the sujood on the turba, make sure that there's no obstacles on the turba between the forehead and the place of the sujood, the turba itself.
Okay.
So let's say any kind that prevents touching the forehead on the turba.
So it forms a preventive layer.
Yes, exactly. Okay. Yes, a layer. For example, let's say Vaseline. For example, if someone rubs that amount, big amount of that, would prevent the touch of the skin of the forehead on the turba. There's no issue with regard to just change of color. Usually the color changes due to the constant sujood, due to the sweat, for example.
Yeah.
So that's fine. You can still pray on it.
Okay. Second question says, Assalamu alaikum. After marriage, the wife came to know that her husband is insane. Could you please advise me whether that marriage was valid? If it is valid, can the wife demand a divorce from her side? And this person is asking the opinion of Ayatollah Al-Hakim.
Yes, the Sayyid mentions that the wife has the right to annul the marriage, the contract, without divorce. Because here we have what is known as a aib, a fault or defect in this individual, in the husband. So she has the right to annul this contract, this marriage. Be it this issue was raised before marriage or after marriage. Doesn't make a difference. She can actually do the fasakh or annul the marriage contract.
Oh, nice. Now, this next question was one which before the show I was looking at, and I said, wow, whoever came up with that question is pretty good. According to Ayatollah Sayyid Ali Sistani, if a person goes to the moon, to which direction should he pray? I'm presuming the person who asked is an astronaut of some sort.
Exactly. No, inshallah, we'll have Muslims who will, inshallah, go to the moon. And because we are a bit late from the Western world. Yes, if somebody is on the moon, they can actually pray towards the planet Earth. So the Earth would be the Qibla of the one who is on the moon.
Okay.
That's
so you don't have to wait for Mecca to come back in a circle.
Not really. It's difficult.
The next one, Sheikhna, says, Assalamu alaikum. If, because you know how some people, they just want to do their salah in 30 seconds. If one deliberately utters the dhikr before bowing to the level required for ruku', or if one deliberately raises his head from the state of ruku' before finishing the obligatory dhikr, what would be his ruling?
Well, one of the conditions of Salah that you must be in a stable condition in all stages of Salah. You know, when you're in the standing position, in the rukuk position, in sujood. So if somebody raises his head from the rukuk, before completing the dhikr, so saying Subhan Rabbi al-Azim wa bihamdih, and he stands up, then the salah becomes batil. Yes, the one have to repeat the salah again. You must be in a stable condition and position, recite the dhikr completely, and then you can raise your head and go towards the sujood.
That's for everyone who finishes their salah in 30 seconds. Sheikhna, the next question that says, Assalamu alaikum, is it permissible to play with cards on the electronic devices such as computers and smartphones?
Well, in overall, playing with the games which are known as gambling games, in this title, it's absolutely haram and forbidden. Now, of course, with or without betting. So some ask that, can I play chess without betting? Because these are made specifically for the gambling purpose in the old days, for example. They become now haram to be used, even without betting, without paying money. And the Sayyid mentioned there's no difference between the hurma, the prohibition of playing it via the, let's say, computer or iPad and so forth.
Okay.
The hurma remains. But I think some ulama would consider some of the games are allowed to be played. But, so you have to go refer back to your marja to see which games you're allowed to play on the screen.
So get the opinion of your marja on it. Now, this next question obviously leads on from the previous question. It says, what are the categories of gambling devices?
Basically, you have the first category in which we just mentioned now, such as the chess, the domino, and the cards, and so forth, which are originally haram because they were made for gambling purposes. The second type or category is the games in which you turn it to become haram by betting.
Okay.
So let's say the matchbox, snakes and ladder, for example. If you put conditions of betting, then it becomes haram to play.
Okay.
Because there's now betting. So these are two types of the haram categories of gambling. In which also there is a hadith I would like to mention, interestingly, about the gambling from Imam As-Sadiq alayhi salam. في قول الله عز وجل. So the Imam gives the tafsir or the meaning of this holy verse. In Surah number 4, ayah 29. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. يا أيها الذين آمنوا لا تأكلوا أموالكم بينكم بالباطل. O you who believe, do not consume each other's wealth unjustly. The Imam says this consuming the wealth unjustly between each other, huwa al-qimar, the Imam says. It is gambling. So we have to make sure that we are refrain from all types of gambling games because there are consequences of in this dunya and in the hereafter as well. So best thing to avoid all these haram acts.
Just ihtiyat, as in just a precaution. Wajib.
You have to avoid it.
Obligatory precaution, now, this is for all the seafood lovers. This question says, according to Ayatollah Al-Khoi, is it permissible to eat crabs?
No, it is not permissible. Why? There's a hadith from Imam As-Sadiq alayhi salam again. He says, "Kul min as-samaki ma kana lahu fulus." Eat from the fish which has scales. The crabs have no scales. Wala ta'kul, this is amur, wajib. You have to follow the Imam alayhi salam. If you are from the Sukh of Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam. Wala ta'kul minhu ma laysa lahu falas. If there is no scales, then you're not allowed to eat it.
Okay.
So we have been instructed by Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam not to eat any fish except the ones with scales. And of course the prawns is exception.
Prawns is an exception, so no crabs, no lobster for you seafood lovers. This next question says, Assalamu alaikum, if a person dies and has a debt and leaves behind a wealth that is liable to zakat, what would be the ruling in this case?
Well, in this case, it becomes mandatory and wajib to deduct the zakat from his entire wealth before distributing the inheritance or the debts.
Okay.
So it's important that the one to remove this amount of zakat, give it to those who are mustahaq, and then give back the rest of the wealth.
Okay.
To those who are.
Now, this next question says, Salaamu Alaikum, my question is, according to Ayatollah Bashir al-Najafi, it is mentioned in the scholars' treatise, may Allah be merciful with the late and protect the living, that the enemy of the Ahlul Bayt alayhim as-salam is najis. Now, are the ISIS members considered enemies of the Ahlul Bayt alayhim as-salam and therefore najis?
Ayatollah Bashir mentions that whoever shows animosity to Ahlul Bayt alayhim as-salam is najis, as you know.
Mm-hmm.
Then he says, why should you have doubt in ISIS? Let me again mention a hadith from this, the blessed Imam As-Sadiq alayhi salam, again with this regard. It's important to understand that not necessarily for the one to come forward and says, I hate Ali alayhi salam, for example. I don't like Hassan al-Hussein alayhi salam.
Mm-hmm.
Not necessarily, or curse them, na'udhu billah, or make la'na upon them, na'udhu billah. The Imam As-Sadiq, he says and states, in a long hadith, he says, "An-nasiba man nasaba lakum." The nasib, the one who shows animosity, the ones who shows hostility towards you, O Shia, he's the nasib. He is the nasibi. وَهُوَ يَعْلَمُ أَنَّكُمْ تَتَوَلَّوْنَا. Why? Because you love us. You follow us. وَأَنَّكُمْ مِنْ شِيَعَتِنَا. Because you follow us, you're from the Shia, he shows animosity and hatred towards you.
Okay.
So they are nasib as well.
Uh-huh.
Another hadith, and this shows how Allah would treat those nawasib,
yeah,
those who kill the Shia of Ahlul Bayt alayhim salam, because they love Hassan and Hussein salam Allah alayhim and Fatima alayhi salam. A hadith from Imam al-Ja'far, about Ja'far, Imam al-Baqir alayhi salam. He says, "Inna aduwa aliyyin alayhi salam la yakhruju min ad-dunya." The enemy of Ali alayhi salam, he won't leave this world, he won't depart this world, except hatta yajra'a jur'atan min al-hamim, until he is given a sip from the boiled water of extreme heated water from the hellfire. He's still in dunya, imagine, not in akhirah. He is still in dunya in his last moments of this world, in, as we mentioned it, ihtidar, as they say it.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So he's given that sip of na'udhu billah boiled water from the hellfire, and then he leaves this world in this situation.
Allah.
You know, being in this position of enmity towards Ali alayhi salam and his family would end up into hellfire. Whoever you are, you must follow Ahl Bayt alayhi salam. Kitab Allah wa 'itrat Ahl Bayti. This is the advice of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi, to follow the two weighty things, الثقلان.
Ahsan, Sheikh. Now, this next question says, Salaamu Alaikum, if one deposits the khums sum in a bank account and some interest is earned on the sum, to whom does the interest belong?
It belongs to the khums, because this is specifically for the khums. So whatever comes as profits or interest will remain for the khums.
So nothing, you can't take the interest that's come from it. It goes to the khums.
Exactly. But this money now is حقوق الشرعية. You can't touch it. It's for the two sections of the khums, سهم السادة and سهم الإمام عليه السلام.
Uh-huh.
It's out of your wealth, خلاص.
Uh-huh.
No more considered by party for wealth.
Ahsan. This next question says, Salaamu Alaikum, according to Ayatollah Sayyid Ali Sistani, can a husband and wife kiss or hug, etc., one another in public places, for example, greeting and welcoming one another in the airport, which is quite common in Europe?
The Sayyid mentions that it is not prohibited, it's not haram for the one to embrace, for example, his or hug his wife or vice versa, as long as she's observing the hijab.
Okay.
And number two, there's no temptation or lust, because sometimes you see some people, the way they embrace and hug would raise the lust and arouses the lust in front of the onlookers.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So the Sayyid mentions it's better to avoid such in the public.
Uh-huh.
So just a, you know, normal hug, you know, just a,
yeah,
I don't know, to the shoulder, for example.
Exactly, yeah.
Just to avoid that temptation or mm-hmm. arouse of the lust.
Ahsantum, Sheikh. Now, we are going to go for a short break, my dear brothers and sisters. But do remember, this is a live show. You can call in to ask Sheikh your questions. You can call in on 0203-515-0199. Or you can email us on ahkamsos@imamhussein.tv. Our staff are checking the emails. And you can also WhatsApp in your questions to the number down below. We'll see you after this short break. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah wa barakatuh. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah wa barakatuh, dear brothers and sisters and dear viewers, wherever you may be, and welcome back to this Ahkam SOS episode. Do remember that this is a live show. You can call in to ask the Sheikh your questions on the 0203-515-0199. WhatsApp in your questions to the number down below or email us on ahkamsos@imamhussein.tv. Now, Sheikh, before the break, we were discussing various topics, various interesting, very interesting questions coming in from the viewers. This next question comes in and it says, Salaamu Alaikum, if one has enough money to go to Hajj and returns to his hometown, but he does not own a house, is the Hajj of a higher priority or is buying a house higher?
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Well, the Hajj is mandatory, is wajib, mm-hmm. as long as you're mustati' now. You have the means to go to Hajj, you have the money, you paid the khums, for example, you must go to the Hajj. There's no way. Mm-hmm. Unless there is severe discomfort that if you don't buy the house, you'll be like, for example, the homeless people,
mm-hmm.
for example. Or you'll be given a very bad accommodation in which it's shared, the kitchen is shared, the bathroom is shared, especially the COVID situation.
Yeah.
Then if it's a shari'i, severe discomfort, then you can leave the Hajj and put the money to buy the house.
Okay, Hassan. Now this next question comes in and it says, Salaamu Alaikum. Now according to Ayatollah Sayyid Al-Hakim, I would like to marry a religious girl, but it is difficult to ascertain whether a particular girl is religious or not by one visit or a couple of visits. What do you suggest?
Well, the Sayyid mentions that you can go and search about the girl
mm-hmm.
To find out if she's religious, chaste, modest, you know, has that all features of dignity, for example, as a female, as a mu'min woman, inshallah. And you can ask the friends, family about her. Mm-hmm. But in overall, if you find the faith, the iman in her, and the akhlaq, then you can go forward after you ask the background of this female. And likewise, checks. Likewise, they have to search for the male as well.
Inshallah, the brother gets married in the quickest time possible. Now, this next question comes in and it says, Salaamu Alaikum, if one is in an area on earth where an earthquake occurs once or more every day, is it mandatory to perform multiple Salat al-Ayat?
Well, it is not mandatory to perform for every quake a separate Salah.
Mm-hmm.
So the one can actually perform one Salah each day for the multiple of quakes.
Uh-huh, okay.
So let's say it's a continuous quakes every day for the next, let's say, 7 days. So one Salah for each day for the multiple quakes.
Uh-huh,
that will be sufficient. Yeah.
Okay. This question says, Salaamu Alaikum, is Qunut obligatory in Salah?
Qunut in overall is an act of mustahab to perform in all Salah, be it the mustahab Salah or the wajib Salah. However, it's mustahab precaution, istihbab ihtiyati. It's better to bring it in the Salah and shouldn't be missed in overall, especially in the wajib Salah. So if, it's better for the one to bring these mustahabbat to elevate his status before Allah Azza wa Jal and to reach that level of perfection.
Mm-hmm.
So the more mustahabbat in salah, the more you would gradually, you know, elevate mm-hmm. towards the perfection. And especially if you can also perform the mustahabbat, you know, namaz, shab, salat al-layl, ghufayla, and so forth. That would be great as well.
Ahsantum, Shaykhna. Now, this next question says, Salaamu Alaikum, can one remain silent too long in salah? For example, to listen to the doorbell ring.
If someone remains too long silent, in which that it destroys the state of the salah.
Yeah.
So if somebody comes in and he says, well, he's not praying, he's just pondering or reflecting,
uh-huh.
he's no longer praying, then the salah becomes batil and void. The one should repeat it.
Uh-huh.
You shouldn't miss any of these acts, because otherwise, if you leave these acts, if you put like a gap, long gap, then the salah becomes batil.
But that, would this apply, for example, if you're in salah jama'ah, where the imam who's reciting the salah, for example, they recite it very slow between themselves, but then you recite it very fast, and then you're just standing there waiting for him to obviously proceed?
Well, you have to, in terms of the jama'ah, to keep quiet when the imam is reciting hamd and surah.
Yeah.
So you can also, for example, recite dhikr. So yeah. The imam is reciting hamd and surah, you say, La ilallah, subhanallah,
uh-huh.
alhamdulillah,
okay.
You can.
Okay.
There's
okay.
no issue with it.
Okay, now this next question says, Salaamu alaykum, if an event such as a solar or a lunar eclipse or earthquake takes place and a woman is in a state of menstruation, is it mandatory upon her to perform Salat al-Ayat?
For such individual, the Salat al-Ayat would not be wajib in this case. So, nor she needs to do the qada afterwards. Because she is now in a state in which she doesn't have to offer any salah.
Mm-hmm.
And salat al-Ayat is wajib as well.
Yeah.
So there's no salah upon her and no qada upon her. But the Sayyid mentions that it is as a precaution, mustahab, mm-hmm. For the ladies to actually perform the salah afterwards when she becomes tahir and pure.
Uh-huh.
Just recite the salah again. Otherwise, it's not wajib, because her taklif mm-hmm. in those days of 5 to 7 days
yeah.
period, there's no taklif to perform the salah.
Uh-huh. Okay.
So she is off in terms of the wajib.
Perfect. Ahsantum, Sheikhna, and thank you so much to the dear viewers for sending in your questions. Inshallah, the Sheikh managed to answer the questions, and inshallah you understood and took from that. We are running these live shows, inshallah. Do call in. Don't be shy. Call the ask the Sheikh your questions. 0203-515-0199. Email in to ahkamsos@imamhussain.tv or WhatsApp in your questions to the number down below, to the WhatsApp number. And inshallah, from me and the Sheikh, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah wa barakatuh.
We question our daily position, seeking answers and definitions. Get the queries off your chest with Ahkam SOS.